I'm Dr. Aley Kalapila from Emory University, and in this National HIV Curriculum mini-lecture, I'm going to provide a brief review on the prevention of Toxoplasma encephalitis in people living with HIV. So this is going to be the outline of my talk. I will start with some background and rationale, followed by a discussion on screening and prevention guidance. After that, we'll talk about medication side effects, and then finally, we'll have a summary. Now, diving right into background and rationale. So, Toxoplasma encephalitis is caused by Toxoplasma gondii, which is a protozoal parasite that typically causes an encephalitis in profoundly immunocompromised individuals. Now, encephalitis is probably one of the most common manifestations seen with Toxoplasma infection, but other clinical presentations have been described in the literature, including retinitis and pneumonia. Toxoplasmosis is a foodborne illness, and so one can get exposed to the organism by accidental ingestion. So risk factors for this would include contact with cat feces, for example, or eating undercooked red meat or raw shellfish. Once the accidental ingestion occurs, the organism can form tissue cysts in the brain, the eyes, the myocardium, and the skeletal muscle. Now, these cysts can actually be present lifelong, and individuals, though, can remain asymptomatic, meaning that they have essentially a latent infection. But in people with HIV who have these cysts, if their CD4 count drops to below 100 and they are not taking prophylactic medications, the cysts can then reactivate and cause encephalitis symptoms, which include fever, headache, altered mental status, and seizures. Now let's discuss screening for toxoplasma exposure. Now, because of the risk of significant neurological disease with toxoplasma encephalitis, the adult and adolescent opportunistic infection guidelines recommend that all people with HIV be screened for prior toxoplasma exposure at the time of their initial HIV diagnosis. This is done by checking serum for IgG antibodies against toxoplasma. Additionally, if these individuals have a negative serum toxo IgG, they should be rescreened if their CD4 count drops to less than 100 and they are not already taking prophylactic medications to prevent toxoplasma reactivation. So this slide shows some counseling that you can provide to individuals who have a negative serum toxo IgG at baseline. And by taking these precautions, it can actually help them reduce the risk of toxoplasmosis. So some advice here that you can give is to not change the cat litter box, or if they are going to change the cat litter box, you can tell the individual to wear gloves and, of course, to wash hands thoroughly after. You want to avoid consumption of undercooked meat or raw shellfish, and also avoid consumption of unpasteurized dairy products. If they're going to consume raw fruits or vegetables, you should tell them to wash them thoroughly prior to eating them. And if handling soil, they should also wear gloves and wash hands afterwards as well. So now let's move on to how to prevent toxoplasmosis if you have a history of prior exposure. For people with HIV, you would initiate primary prophylaxis for toxoplasma encephalitis if they have a serum toxo IgG that is positive and they have a CD4 count less than 100. You need to have both of these criteria in order to be eligible to receive primary prophylaxis. So these are your medication options for primary prophylaxis to prevent reactivation of toxoplasma. The first line regimen that you should ideally be using is trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole, which I will refer to as trim sulfa. And the preferred dosing for this is to take one double strength tablet once a day. Now, note here that this is the same dosing that we use for pneumocystis prophylaxis when the CD4 count is less than 200. So this is actually quite convenient that trim sulfa provides prophylaxis against both pneumocystis and toxoplasmosis. Alternative dosing for trim sulfa include taking a single-strength tablet once a day or taking a double-strength tablet three times a week. Other regimens for individuals who may be intolerant of trim sulfa include two different options. So the first is a combined regimen of dapsone, pyrimethamine, and leucovorin. And a couple of additional points to remember for this regimen. So the first is you really want to check a G6PD level prior to administering dapsone. Because if you give dapsone to someone with G6PD deficiency, you can cause a hemolytic anemia. Another issue with this regimen of dapsone, pyrimethamine, and leucovorin is that it is actually very expensive, and this is primarily driven by the exorbitant cost of pyrimethamine in the United States. The second alternative regimen for toxoplasma prevention for those intolerant of trimsulfa is atovaquone. Now, atovaquone can be taken by itself, or it can be taken in combination with pyrimethamine and leucovorin. Atovaquone is actually a liquid medication, and the main complaint that most patients have about this medicine is that it actually tastes pretty bad. It is also an expensive medication, but the cost of atovaquone is not quite as expensive as the cost of pyrimethamine. Now, prophylactic medications can be discontinued if the patient is on combination antiretroviral therapy and they have a sustained rise in CD4 count to over 200 for at least 3 months. You can consider discontinuing prophylaxis for individuals who have a CD4 count between 100 and 200, provided that they are on combination antiretroviral therapy and they have achieved viral suppression for at least 3 months or more. So this slide goes over when to restart primary prophylaxis for toxoplasma encephalitis if it was previously discontinued. So you would want to resume primary prophylaxis for toxo in individuals whose CD4 count drops to less than 100, and this is regardless of what their viral load might be, or you need to resume toxo prophylaxis in individuals whose CD4 count is between 100 and 200 if they have a detectable HIV viral load. Now, let's go over some of the common side effects associated with medications used for toxoplasma prophylaxis. This table indicates the most commonly reported or seen side effects of medications that are used for toxoplasma prophylaxis. With trimsulfa, you may see renal dysfunction, hyperkalemia, leukopenia, particularly neutropenia. You can get a hepatitis or a transaminitis. Individuals might get a mild rash with trimsulfa, or on the more severe spectrum, they can get Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Now with dapsone, dapsone contains a sulfa moiety. So if an individual has a severe reaction to trimsulfa, like Stevens-Johnson syndrome, for example, then you should not be using dapsone in these patients. If the reaction to trimsulfa is mild, like a transaminitis, for instance, or a leukopenia, then you can try dapsone as part of their alternative toxoplasma prophylaxis regimen. Methemoglobinemia can be seen with dapsone use. And then finally, what I had mentioned previously, that individuals with G6PD deficiency taking dapsone can develop a hemolytic anemia. So again, driving home the fact that it is important to check a G6PD level and ensure that it is normal prior to initiating dapsone as part of someone's toxoplasma prophylaxis regimen. Now, atovaquone doesn't have too many major side effects except that it tastes bad. Pyrimethamine is very expensive. It can cause nausea and vomiting, and it can also cause bone marrow suppression if it is not co-administered with leucovorin. So let's review some key points regarding toxoplasma prophylaxis. In people with HIV who are seropositive for toxoplasma IgG, primary prophylaxis is indicated when the CD4 count is less than 100 to prevent toxoplasma reactivation. The preferred prophylactic medication to be used is trimsulfa. Alternative regimens include dapsone with pyrimethamine and leucovorin, or atovaquone, which can be administered by itself or in combination with pyrimethamine and leucovorin. Remember to always check a G6PD level prior to using dapsone to avoid risk of hemolytic anemia. Dapsone has a sulfa moiety, so if the patient is intolerant of trimsulfa, your ability to use dapsone depends on the severity of the patient's reaction to trimsulfa. Finally, prophylaxis can be discontinued once the patient has achieved immune reconstitution on antiretroviral therapy.
The production of this national HIV curriculum mini lecture was supported by grant U10HA32104 from the Health Resources and Services Administration of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Its contents are solely the responsibility of the University of Washington Idea Program and do not necessarily represent the official views of HRSA or HHS.